this morning. We're so glad you're here with us.
He's coming on the clouds. Kings and kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break. His broken hearts declare his praise. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? And our God is the Lion of Judah. He is roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before him. And our God is the Lamb. For the sin of the world, his blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before him.
Single word, you ignite the
standing on you. We stand in awe of you, Christ, the way, the life, the truth. We stand in awe of you. And what king will leave his throne, set his crown aside for his own creation? Sin and die, unrelenting love, never ending grace. Oh God, we praise your name.
Standing up,
we stand in awe of you. We stand in awe of you, Christ, the way. Things like you do, and God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do. Yeah.
We invite you to pray this with us this morning over our church.
God, I look to you. I won't be overwhelmed. Give me vision to see things like you do. And God, I look to you. You're where my help comes from. Give me wisdom. You know just what to do. And I will love you, Lord, my strength. Just what to do, and I
this morning.
Hallelujah, our God reigns. Hallelujah, our God reigns. Forever all my days. Hallelujah. And hallelujah, our God reigns.
You sing it out.
Forever all my days is hallelujah. Forever all my days is hallelujah. Forever all my days is
And he is jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so. Like a hurricane, I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affection are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so.
Sing it out this morning. Yeah,
he
Amen. And be seated.
Let's worship the Lord through our giving today. Our guys are going to start in the back, so let's do that right now. Amen. Today we're in the 14th chapter of the book of John, continuing our series, Church Family Values. You know, every family, they have their own unique and special values that help them to be a part of the family unit, to have a sense of togetherness. Every family has things that just really are important to them, whether it's like meeting at grandma's every Sunday afternoon, or maybe trying at least one night during the week to have a sit-down family dinner together. Maybe even some families just say, you know what, one of the values of our family is that we're always going to cherish and treasure open and honest communication. That we just want everyone to always feel like you can share your heart and you can share your feelings. And we're not going to go to bed at night carrying a bunch of burdens and things that are troubling us. But these are things that we just share in our family. Their values, they make us special. It's almost like they become the unspoken expectations within the family. You just kind of, over time, you grow to expect that everyone's going to kind of embrace those values and everyone's going to adopt them, and it's really going to bring the family together into a strong and cohesive unit. The reality is, church families are the same. Apart from doctrinal agreement, or apart from accepted exercises or routines, or even biblical convictions, every church family also has its own unique set of family values. In this series, Church Family Values, we're exploring ours. Here at First Missionary, these family values have been things that we have seen growing and developing over time. We know that in a growing church family or in a growing church community, you need to communicate. Amen? You need to communicate. You need to share. And so we felt it's just really, really important to start to communicate and to share some of these values that are already within our hearts, that are already within our fellowship. But it's important for us to talk about these, and in the days and the years and ministry opportunities to come, we continue to strengthen these values and share these values, and our hearts really, really, really come around these values. And so whoever walks in the doors, whoever, they can know, they can see what this church family thinks is important. Last week we talked about the value of being yourself. Of being yourself. And we looked at the biblical example of Jesus and the woman who was regarded as a sinner when she came to him. People were talking about her behind her back, and she wept by his feet, and her tears anointed his feet. She perfumed his feet with a sweet smelling fragrance. He welcomed her. He embraced her. He didn't say, "You got to be a certain way to come to me. You got to look a certain way." His message was very simple. Be yourself. Just come to me as you are with all the baggage and load that you've got. Come to me. And what we realize is this. Very rarely do people ever come to Jesus and are a part of His presence where they don't change. They come one way, but then they leave His presence very, very different. So the life change is a result of coming to Jesus, but it was never a requirement for coming to Jesus. So one of our values as a church body and family is, please, by all means, be yourself. We move from there to the one we're going to start talking about today. We're just going to hit on it very briefly today. And it has to do with belonging. You go from believing... I'm sorry, let me back up. That's where we're going next. You go from being yourself to then belonging. Is this a place for me? Do people really like me here? Can I fit in? Can I find some acceptance here? I used an example last week in our own body of a young man who followed this model to a T. Who followed it to a T. He came here as himself. He found a place to belong. And then after that, he accepted Jesus as his Savior. We got to baptize him right over here in the baptistry behind me. So today, we're talking about the importance of belonging, watch this, before you believe. That's a little different than maybe our church past or our history, because many times we required people, you got to believe first, or you got to behave a certain way or look a certain way, then you can belong. Well, the culture is shifting and changing dramatically. Our culture today looks a whole lot like the first century culture that Jesus ministered to. And here's our heart's conviction, okay? If we are the body of Christ, then our ministry and our heart is to look like Jesus. So this is exactly what was taking place with him. John chapter 14, listen to these words. We're going to comment briefly on this today and share some other things with you. Jesus said to his disciples, "Let not your heart be troubled. Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you, for I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How do we know the way?" And Jesus said to him, one of my favorite verses in all of Scripture, John 14, 6, Jesus said to him, hey, let's just say this together. Jesus said, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father." Amen. "But through me." And then notice this in verse 7. Jesus says, "If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, you know him and have seen him." Jesus' way of saying, if you want to know the heart of God, look at me. You want to see how God interacts with people? Look at me. You want to see God in your midst? Look to me. And many times today in our culture, when people are looking for God, where should they go? The body of Christ that is reflecting the heart of Christ, who reflects the very being and essence of who? Of God. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on, you know Him and have seen Him. Now, what's Philip's response here? Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us. Philip had been walking with Jesus as a called disciple. Philip was there as an original part of the 12 who were called to be His disciples and followers. There had been some time that had passed from the point of His initial welcoming. Listen to this. His welcoming into the presence of Jesus to this conversation right here. And notice what happens in Philip, or with Philip. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father. It is enough for us. And then Jesus said to him, watch this. Have I been so long with you, and yet you have not known? You have not come to know me. Have I been so long with you, and yet you have not come to what? You have not come to know me. Philip, he who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show? How can you say, show us the Father? Next verse. How can you say, show us the Father? We stop right there, but let's come back to this real quick. Have I been so long with you, and yet you have not come to know me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. How do you say, there you go, show us the Father? Here's what we know, okay? Philip was not there yet. There was a lot about Jesus he had not come to embrace. He did not, at this point, Philip did not know the heart or the essence of who Jesus is. He had not made the God connection with Jesus. He knew some things about Jesus. He'd even walked with Jesus, you know, in that physical realm of doing life with Jesus. But yet in all those dealings, all that time of knowing about Jesus, Philip had yet to come to actually know Jesus. So there's even a process with Philip where he goes from coming as he is, being yourself. Before he comes to that point of believing who Jesus is, he found an arena, listen to this, an arena of acceptance, an arena of love, and he found an arena of belonging in the presence of Jesus before he ever got to the point of really knowing and believing who Jesus is. This is a process that Philip was in. And many of us today are in a process. People all around us are wanting to come to know God, the heart of God. They come here, they want to know, can I be myself? Can I belong here? And then, who is Jesus in your midst? Today we're going to talk about process, about what it means to be in process. We move from church family values to where we are currently, where we are presently in the life of our church. Just a few months ago, Tom Rainer wrote an article. He is the president of Lifeway. Lifeway is the publishing arm of the Southern Baptist Convention. Tom Rainer writes a lot about churches and church life and church experiences. And Tom wrote this particular article, and this is what it was entitled, and please listen carefully today. 8 Reasons Many Bible Belt Churches Are in Trouble. 8 Reasons Many Bible Belt Churches Are in Trouble. By the way, we live in the Bible Belt. Sometimes it's often referred to as the Bible Bubble because we have a very neat place of living here in the South. And as you saw the news this week, there is a very diverse world out around us. And many times living here in the good old Bible Belt is not always a picture of what's happening in some of our urban centers, our bigger cities, but they are having a huge impact and effect upon our lives. Here's what he said real quick. He says, they don't recognize the decline in cultural Christianity. They refuse to admit the world has changed around them. They have many church rules, and for some reason, people wonder why those on the outside are not interested in their churches. He says they have leaders who have never led in the highly churched, unchurched mission field. Whether you like it or not, Tom Rainer says, Birmingham and Nashville in that regard are looking more like Spokane and Boston. They confuse traditions with truth, a dangerous reality when we're trying to engage our world and community. He says they do outreach the way they've always done it. They have significant conflict due to frustration. The changes around them can be frustrating. The changes within their church can be frustrating. And sometimes that frustration leads to great conflict. He says they're slow to respond. Slow to respond. I'll never forget Jerry Bennett calling me up one day in the process that we're in and relocating construction to a new property. Jerry Bennett called me up and said, Brother Allen, there's property out on 641. The hospital wants to sell it. Do you think we can get our people together and make some kind of decision or move this week? And I said, Jerry Bennett, we're a Baptist church. We can't buy a pencil in a week, let alone buy 18 acres of property. So we wait, we pray. By the way, if you don't know the story or history of that, you know how many people bid on that property when it went to the newspaper? You know how many people bid on it to buy it? Zero. And then the hospital turned around, dealt directly with us, set a price, and we were able to buy that property many years ago. He says this, he says, they have significant facility changes. Many of these churches were built for one big crowd, one day a week, 1 hour a week. They have old and dated education and rec facilities as well. And listen to this. A lot of their funds go to keep the lights on. Very similar to our situation even here. When you consider how much we pay in our utility costs in regards or comparison to our ministries, we spend a whole lot more money keeping the lights on than we do for discipleship, our service ministries, all of that combined. So several years ago, some leaders of our church came together. They looked at our challenges here. There's a neat story behind it. Neat story. I'll share it with you, hopefully, in the days to come. A neat story of how we got to where we are today, looking at facilities, wanting to make some changes and doing a data study and a feasibility study, coming to where we are even today. It's a great story. Tremendous story of God's sustaining grace. And in the weeks leading up to today, we've researched our history. We looked at our history. And my goodness, folks, listen to me. God's sustaining grace has been there over us even from our very beginning. It's been a tremendous process. And I'm just so humble and so thankful to be a part of it. And I don't deserve it. I don't deserve to be where I'm standing today. You don't deserve to be where you're sitting today. We don't deserve to be where we're at today. But it's been God's sustaining grace that's carried us to this point. His sustaining grace in my marriage, in my family, my relationships, my ministry. It is God's sustaining grace. That's why we are here today. This little video clip shows us about process and what it takes. I think some of you will recognize this from the 2016 Summer Olympics. This is a great picture, a great image, a great video. It's just very, very short, but watch this, and we need to be reminded of the process.
USA pressing him, Bolt in front. He's getting to the front now from Japan, and the star of the show does it again. Usain says goodbye to the Olympic Games. Japan gets a surprise silver medal, and the United States have finished third.
Y'all remember that? What a great scene in Olympic history. Usain Bolt leading the men's 4x100 relay team to a gold medal. Now, all the cameras and everything was on Usain Bolt, and good reason for that. But one thing here you don't see in that shot, in that 4x100 relay, here's what you don't see. You don't see the guy who ran the first leg. You don't see the guy who ran the second leg. You don't see the successful transitioning of the baton. You don't see the guy who ran the third leg. And you don't see the guy, maybe a very, very short picture of the guy that handed the baton to Usain Bolt. Folks, listen to me. Generation after generation, person to person, we are a process of a relay event. We have carried the gospel. People have shared with us the gospel. They've given us the gospel. There have been the transitioning of batons along the way. Let's go back a picture here real quick to our first church building, 1933, 1934 here on here on 13th Street. Let's go to the very first one. The very first one. It would have been the last one. There you go. How many of y'all were here when this building was erected, when this building was built? Okay, nobody. Okay, yeah. Don't date yourselves, ladies, okay? Who was built? Someone here, 1933. You were here when this building was built. There's not one single person. Gene, were you here when this building was built? 1933? There you go. You got one person who was here in 1933-34 when this building was built. 1958, we know there are several other people here. Let's go to the next shot of our church facilities. 1958, I read the article to you in the newspaper. The church built a modern church facility. Had a very unique cross on it. This tower, let's see the tower real quick. A very beautiful, unique tower. And by the way, years ago, people driving up this way could actually see this before it was the one-way street. Nobody in town, nobody in the area had a tower like that. The church played music out of the tower on Sunday mornings. People could hear it from miles around all throughout the city of Benton. Very unique, special place. Built in 1958, the church said, let's move forward. Not too many years ago, we bought property on 641. I want to see some of these old pictures real quick. Some of these old pictures right here. This was right after we bulldozed the property and had it disced. Me and Howard Durham and a few other deacons went out on this property up to our knees in dust and dirt, picking up roots and sticks and load them up on a trailer, throwing them to the side. Here's another picture of the property from the other end. This is our garden spot today. Of course, this was probably about 10 years ago. And then I want to show you this before you bring it up. This is one of my absolute favorite pictures, because this picture helps us to see again how the baton has been passed, how hearts have been in where we are today and moving forward, passing the baton of the gospel. Let's see this next picture. This is my favorite one. Right here. My absolute favorite picture on the property. Because one day, Broil Flat, who was a part of that original team who helped us to purchase this property, Broil Flat said, Allie, let's go out to the property. I had an old BlackBerry phone. I said, Burl, I'm going to take your picture, and I'm going to keep this. Man, I've gone through two computer crashes since that time, and it's only by the sustaining grace of God I was able to find this picture off that old BlackBerry phone a couple of weeks ago, and had to do a bunch of stuff to the file to get it to where you can see it today. But I just want you to understand and to realize that where we are today is because of the process of passing the baton of the gospel from one generation to the next. Even this process we're in today, and as Steve and Danny and these guys come forward this morning to share with you, you are even seeing a process of people who've been involved in this venture for several years now. The baton has been passed. One thing you don't see in the video, come on up here, guys. One thing you don't see in the video of Usain Bolt is this. The guy who finishes the first leg, he gives it his all. When he passes the baton, many times he falls to his knees because he's exhausted, right? You didn't see that. The guy who runs the second leg, the guy who runs the third leg, when they pass the baton, you see him many times fall over. And they're crippled down because they've given their all, but they passed the baton. Today, we just happen to be in a position to be able to carry the baton, and one day, we're all going to get to pass it to somebody else. So, I'm going to turn this over to Steve and to Danny. I'm going to let you know this too, church family. What you're going to see today, I have not seen. Two proposals were shared on Wednesday afternoon. To Steve, Trent, and Danny, I prayed for these guys. I prayed for everybody on our team every day this week. I prayed that they would see God. That was my prayer, that when they saw a proposal that they would see the heart of God. They've spent over a year and a half on vision and vision only. Only on vision. The vision of God for ministry. Before even coming to the design part. And the budget preceded that. I pray this week, God, I pray that they would see you. I pray that when they see the proposal, they'll see you, God. And there's something else I pray for them. I prayed for the team. Thursday night, team came together. I shared my heart with them. I said, I've wanted this to be a joyous process with you, for you. I wanted you to be the best prepared team that you could be. But I pray even now for you, when you see this, you will see God. And you'll know it's Him. Here's the other thing I asked Him to do. To the best of your ability, may you see through the eyes of those who don't know God yet. Because it's not for us. But for those Christ is calling us to reach. I said, may you see this through the eyes of those who don't know church and don't know God and haven't seen God and are looking for a place where they can be themselves, belong, believe, be transformed, and be a blessing. At that, I said, I trust your hearts. 20-something people sitting around a room, and we've prayed for a season of prayer. We've prayed for a season of trust and a season of unity. And I said, I trust your hearts. I trust the heart. I trust the Lord in you. I don't have to see this today. I don't even want to know. When I see it for the very first time, I will see it with the church family. I don't even know the general contractor they've selected. I have no clue. What you're going to hear and see today, I'll be seeing for the very first time with you. And I'm asking you, even right now, pray, trust our team, and let's be unified in how God leads us into the future. So this is going to be exciting. All right, guys, I've said enough.
He said 10 or 15 minutes. I knew better. I knew he couldn't do it in that amount of time. I just want to share my heart with you just for a moment. And I want to reiterate what Brother Allen said this morning, because I think it's a very important part that I don't want to forget, and I don't know if you do not want to forget. But he talked about the groundwork that's been laid in the past here. And as I look around this room this morning, I'm getting a bad echo. Reverb. As I look around the room this morning, there's not very many of those folks still here. But thank the Lord that they had a vision and that they had knowledge and wisdom. Well, we couldn't be standing here at this point where we are today. And I just think we ought to give the Lord a hand clap of praise for that this morning. And if I started naming names, I would leave somebody out, so I'm not going to do that. But there's so many that are on my heart and mind this morning. I just want to share something with you real quick, and then I'm going to turn it over to Trent and Danny. But we've talked a lot about trust, and we've talked a lot about unity, and we've talked a lot about this process. And we've been in this process for a long, long time. And we talked about, Alan said something about, you know, want it to be a joy. And I want you to know my heart and hear my heart this morning. This has been an absolute joy to be a part of. I want you to know that on Wednesday, we had a meeting set up with us, with Trent and Danny and myself at 4:30 here at the church to meet with the first contractor and architect for them to pitch their sales to us and show us how God had spoken to them in this process and what that architect saw. But I was really torn up Wednesday. I don't say this for praise for me at all. I want you to hear my heart. But Danny and myself, and I'm not leaving Trent out, but we were in kind of a unique situation here. Because the two contractors that we selected, that is my top two contractors that I do business with. My top two. And I think Danny would probably say the same thing. I like to eat. You can tell that. I thought, Lord, I'm going to make one of these guys mad at me. One of these guys is going to be happy with me. One's going to be upset with me. I like to eat. I don't want to do anything to jeopardize my relationship that I have with those folks. So here's what I did. I went out to the property, pulled up on it with my truck, and me and God had a long talk. And I said, God, you're going to have to do this. Take me out of the way. You're going to have to do this, and you're going to have to make it so plain and so clear to me that there's absolutely, when we meet tonight, that there's absolutely no question which way you want us to go. I can't do it. So we had that talk. I went on and did something else. And I guess I didn't trust him enough. I had to go back out there just to make sure that he heard me the first time. And I went back over it all with him again. And I'm sure he's saying, Steve, I've got it. I've got it. You just trust me in that. Song we sang this morning. God, I look to you. Give me vision. See things like you. I want you to know that our God, when we seek him, when we ask him, he's faithful, he's just, and he's true. He'll answer. Because he answered for me in a way that literally blew my socks off Wednesday night when they presented. And that's from my heart. I want you to hear that. And that gave me clarity that God is just. God is faithful. I knew that. But he just reassured that with me. Because there was no doubt in my mind. There was no doubt in Trent's mind. There was no doubt in Danny's mind. When we saw the two presentations, we just looked at each other and we knew what we had to pick. So I thank God this morning for that. Sometimes we're slow, but he's always willing and he's always there. And his timing, guys, is perfect. His timing is always perfect in every situation in our life. And I know his timing is perfect in this. I'll turn it over to Trent. I've said enough.
I've got to follow that now, okay? I'm just going to tell you a little bit about the process. We started this about probably this group about a year and a half ago, and we met. We kept meeting and talked about the vision, the mission of the church. And about probably 2 months ago, maybe, they selected the three of us to move forward with this project. So these two guys are contractors, and I've had a little bit of dealings with building the building recently, so I think that's part of the reason we were selected. We decided to do the design build method, which I agree with, and they chose two contractors for us to interview, and I'll tell you, they didn't make a mistake. Both of these groups were outstanding. They're godly people. One thing that made it easy on them when we interviewed both of them, whenever they presented us, both groups said, whichever one you choose, we're fine with it. And I know that was a load off of their mind. I didn't really care, but it was a load off their mind. So
you like to eat too, don't you, brother?
So on Wednesday, we met, we had spent about a month. We gave them about a month to come up with some renderings, some plans. They came to us a couple of times. We met with each contractor and architect two or three times throughout the month. But we gave them about 1 month to come up with these designs. On Wednesday, before we started, I talked to the guys and I said, let's do this a lot like I would hire a principal at a school or a teacher. I said, let's hear both interviews or both presentations before we make any decisions. Let's don't do any talking in between because I don't want our minds swayed one way or the other. And they both agreed with that. So we heard both presentations. And when we finished, we were sitting around sort of looking at each other, and I finally said, guys, I'm just going to cut to the chase. I like this one. And both of them said, that's exactly what I thought. So then on Thursday night, we had to present it to the rest of the committee. There's about 15 others that are on the committee. And I said, let's present it exactly like we had it presented. And we all agreed on that. So we were not going to talk about them in between. We presented them exactly the way they presented to us. And we told them we're not going to talk about it in between. We'll talk about it afterwards. So we did both presentations just like we saw them. Steve came up with a voting ballot. And we had all the families that were involved to fill out a ballot. And when we took the ballot, we went back into a room. And it was absolutely unanimous, the pick. And we hope it is for you today in that process. We didn't try to influence that committee. We let them see the presentations just like we saw them. And it was unanimous between us, and it was unanimous between the committee. So at this time, I'm going to let Danny do the presentation.
Before I get started, I'm not going to add much more, but I would like everybody on the committee to please stand. I'd like everybody once again to see who's on the committee. Mike and Debbie Morgan, J.R. and Laura Reynolds, Lisa and Trent Lovett, Mike and Pat White, Jay and Trista Larkin, and Jamie and Tammy McDaniel, and me and Tracy are the ones that are, I would say, the voting members. Then you have Steve and Leslie, Alan and Emily, Scott and Amber Clapp back there in the back, Cody and Bailey, y'all aren't standing up, and Peter, where are you, Peter? And Peter, that makes up your committee. We are the ones who have been meeting for the last year and a half. Y'all can be seated. Thank you. Let's give them a round of applause, please. I can't wear them and see glares. So let's get started. We are proposing to the church that we enter into a contract with Pinnacle Construction and Integrity Architecture. Pinnacle Construction, as many of y'all know, they're located here in Benton, Kentucky. The president is Dennis Smith. He's the owner. The vice president and project manager for our project will be Craig Schwepman. He is actually lives in Murray. He's been working with Pinnacle for 17 years. He's done several different churches in the area and different buildings. The project superintendent would be Kevin Holzapple. He's from here in Marshall County. I've worked with them extensively, as well as Steve. And let me tell you, we're getting the best that we could get right there. And those two people from Pinnacle. Very good people. Integrity Architecture. When we entered this, we told both contractors, Clark Construction was the other contractor, as well as Pinnacle. We approached them and told them to choose their architects. Pinnacle, through much prayer and much discussion, chose Integrity Architecture. They are actually out of Lexington, Kentucky. They've been in business for 5 to 6 years. They have three principals, one Aaron Bivens, Joe Zraznik, and you'll see on the next screen the other guy, Adam. They come from Murphy Graves Trimble out of Lexington, Kentucky. Their big thing is churches and retail centers. You say, they don't really go together. When you see the design, I think you'll understand what I'm talking about. Very good firm, very in touch with what we wanted to do. Aaron, we met with Aaron two different times. Alan, I think, met with him also. Aaron has a vision that we have. He said he prayed with us. He talked to us. He understood what we wanted to do in ministry. He loved the idea of the garden. He thought that was a wonderful ministry. He loves the idea of the Wednesday night meal ministry. And he tried to incorporate all those things into what he did. He is a member at Southeast Christian.
Yeah, one of the satellite campuses.
He goes to the Richmond Road campus in Lexington. He is very active there. So he has an idea. He knows what we're wanting to do. He understands what we're trying to do.
I think, Danny, we just kind of fell in love with his heart.
Yes.
I mean, he really had a heart for the Lord.
Here's the other principal. He will be our project manager, Adam Gillette. And if we inquire any interior design, it'll be Carrie Hendrickson. So we're to the point, what's the conceptual design? What we need to remember as a body is what we're fixing to show you, the things we're showing you, is all in conceptual design at this point. This is the look that they are proposing that we get, and that look of the building will stay the same. But the placement on the property, the actual floor plan, all of that is still in the design phase. After this process, we'll go into a schematic phase where we'll be actually getting some stuff in stone. So this is our property here at 641 Bypass. This is 641, the Methodist Church, Riley Road. This is where we go out onto Mary Wood. This is an overview layout of the property, what they propose of. Now, I want you to, like I said, this is conceptual, but this is something for us to start with. They're proposing to put the building basically here in the middle of the property, would have parking in behind as well as parking in the front. One of the main things that we talked about that we were really interested in is we wanted to keep the ideal of the lake. We thought that was a good community aspect of it. So we've got the lake up here in the front with a walking trail around it with a couple of pavilions. He really liked the ideal, the thought of the garden. And he's proposed moving, just kind of reshaping the garden, keeping it in the same area, but reshaping and really making it a focal point on the property itself with some more parking right there. Sorry, too many buttons. This was just a proposal as we wanted to add on to the property. We could do phases off to the side, additional parking. And, you know, we even talked about if we wanted to, we could go back with it. You know, there are several different possibilities with this design on how to add to this building or maybe even different locations on the property. Here is what they kind of proposed for a floor plan. Want to start right here in this area. The orange area that you see, the light orange and dark orange, is administration suite as well as adult rooms. The administration suite has a front entry area for where Gail would sit that is security lockable for protection. It has four different office areas along with the meeting room. The adult area was eight classrooms that could be used in different fashions. Oh, there we go. We're highlighting it now. The yellow area. This is your main entry area, your main gathering area. This up here is the area towards 641. This is one towards Marywood. Main entrance coming in here, you have a gathering area for Sunday morning for doing your cafe, your coffee, and donuts. Have a kiosk, welcome center kiosk in the center. Look at this right here. This is kind of unique. I kind of really was stunned by it. I never thought of anything like it, but it is really cool. This is a multi-purpose gathering entry area. The concept here is on Wednesday nights or possibly if we're having a wedding for a reception or whatever. You can block this area off. This is a movable wall that goes up and down and make this into a room where it is cordoned off from your gathering area. We went to Bellevue in Owensboro. This is the best way I know how to explain it, so bear with me. In their gathering area, in their hallways, they did their meal ministry on Wednesday nights. They set tables up all in here. It seemed kind of cluttered, you know, trying to come in with tables and chairs everywhere. So we told them we wanted a separate area. Well, they come up with the idea of doing it like this, where it could be a multi-purpose area. Where are we at here? This area right here, they're proposing to be a youth area One thing that we already talked to them about, they had a little check-in area for youth. We didn't see that that was a necessity at this time. Maybe making that into one big worship area for the youth. The light blue area is your children's area. Security area there to check in, to go in to your different classrooms. You have 7 classrooms there with a restrooms built into the secure area with one large worship area. One thing we did talk to them about was adding a different hallway, a different exit. So that way you won't have everything bottlenecked right here going in and out. And because we do want to make sure that it's a secure area. Auditorium. The auditorium is actually large enough to hold a junior high basketball, which is 84 by 50. So this room is actually 90 by 90, what they have proposed. It holds 450 people. We've talked about maybe cutting that down a little bit to give us a little more classroom space, a little more storage space. But at this point, we're just not sure what's going to happen right there. Our stage area is down here in the corner. This would be our baptistry area. That would be off to the side. And there will be some changing area, bathroom area back here. These rooms right here are all storage area for chairs and tables and chairs. And your AVL area will be up above this vestibule on a little upstairs part. AVL is your audio video lighting. That's what we do back in the corner. That's what it'd be Taylor and Stephanie's place. We have a storage area, hallway going back to the backstage where you can get access to the stage and not have to interrupt during the service. Go back. Kitchen, thank you. Purple area is the kitchen area. And right here is the cafe serving area. We talked to them about this area. I'm going to hit on it first. Not so sure that we need that right there like that because we have the setting area here. May just do coffee and donuts and stuff off of here. The ones that went to Bellevue know that's what we saw, and that worked really well. Might use that for something else. The kitchen area is 2.5 times the size of what we have now. We told them that we explained to Aaron and to Craig at Pinnacle that the meal ministry was a big part of our ministry, and that we wanted a large kitchen for the ladies to be able to prepare food. The kitchen will have commercial equipment in it. We're not sure if we will be taking some that we have here or if we'll be getting all new. It depends on what happens with this facility. You have a pantry storage area right off the back of the kitchen here, that gray area. One thing I did not mention was you have 2 bathroom locations, both off of the gathering area, the hallways, besides the ones in the children. Yes, one in administration too. I forgot about that. The administration area can be locked down where that's the only place that can be got into during the week, where you won't have to go through the main building. I know that's a concern now at sometimes on whether getting to the office that people could come through here and go not know that. So we could actually lock that all down where nobody could get in to her from any point. That's pretty much the proposed floor plan. Like I said, that's all conceptual. Here's the part that everybody's waiting for. This is a look that they propose, and we really think it's a look that everybody's going to like. We feel like God has led us to this point. Is it going? Yeah, it's turning blue. This is a building that is 22,750 square foot. It is made up of 3 different materials. We have Bedford stone. We have a fiber cement board that looks like wood. And we have some metal. The thought of this is, we We wanted to make an inviting place. Aaron wanted a place that's inviting. The walls on the exterior with a curved sense gives you the idea that it's welcoming you in. Coming from either direction, from north on 641 or south, as you come around the corner from the stoplight, it draws your attention that way because of the curvature. Or as you come from south to north, around the tree line there at Raleigh Road, he's saying that it will grab you. We have a steel cross that is in the center of the canopy here, off of this support. Reaches up above the whole church to identify it, to let people know that it is a church. The background of the wood makes reference to that cross also. Let's know what the cross is, what it's about, and what it stands for. Looking at the front of the building, you can see that you have a drive that is separated, that's underneath the canopy, concrete area for pickup, and a bunch of trees and transparent people. Here's a side view of the building. You see it wraps on around. We still have the wood fiber board with the Bedford rock. Some of that could change depending on cost. And we'd still have the same look of the building though. This is the aerial view of the property from 641 of what it would look like. The thing that I want us to look at here is the lake. We have a beautiful lake out here with a walking trail. We have the two different canopies out here, or pavilions. Very, very community inviting here. This goes back to what we want to do with the community, a place for the community to have to use. I don't know what else to say.
You did tell them who proposed.
No, I hadn't done that. We did talk to them about, we thought that was a lot of a sea of asphalt in the front. We talked about we would like to see the building closer to the lake. We talked about pulling that up and moving this drive up closer and only having visitor and handicap parking in the front. And then, as Trent would say, squish the parking together in the back where the building would kind of hide it more and make it closer to the building. Those are some things that we have talked about as a committee that we would like to, that we will be talking to them about changing. The front walls, they are connected to the building only at the ends here. Out here, they're about 10 foot or so, 15 foot or so in front of the building. Gives you a patio area in between the glass and those columns. The best way that I know how to explain it is it's kind of like hands out there motioning you to come in. That's what it feels like to me. That's we all talked about that was a very unique feature, a very homey feature that we really liked. This is just another view of if we add other phases at a later point, showing you what it would possibly look like adding on to the sides. There we go. This is the other part that everybody wants to know about. Pinnacle Construction set us up a probable construction cost sheet. You can go through and look at the different areas. These are the 16 fundamental areas in the construction project in the spec section. From general conditions all the way down to electrical systems. Electrical is always last in the specs. As you can see, the different costs that they thinking that it might be, how they proposed and budgeted this. A subtotal of all those 16 different systems is $2.76 million. Design fees, $151,000. Brings you up to 2.9 with a contractor fee of $175,000. Our probable construction cost at this point for what we have seen this morning is $3.08 million. But there's always a but. These things are things that were not included. Typically, they're not included in those spec sessions. Your performance and payment bond, builder's risk insurance, special, let's back up, performance and payment bond, that's just a guarantee insurance saying that it will be completed and that it will be paid for. A lot of times with church projects and a lot of time with projects when you're working with a reputable contractor, somebody that you know with, those fees are waived. Builder's risk insurance is saying if anybody gets hurt, anything gets stolen, if the building falls down during the middle of the project, we buy insurance to protect that. That's something that will have to be done, whether it's by us or by the general contractor. Special inspections, those are inspections that have to be done according to the Kentucky Building Code. They are inspections such as your site inspections, your concrete inspections, your seismic inspections. Basically, they want to make sure that the building's safe in case of an earthquake, that it's not going to fall on you. Landscaping, that's something that we either get somebody to do, or you know, that's one of those items that maybe we can come together as a church and do together and have some ownership there. AVL package, that's all your sound, lighting, video. That's a high number of $120,000. FFE package, what's that, Steve? I can't even remember. Furnishings. I had to ask that question the other day. I was stupid. I didn't know. FFE is your furnishings for the new building. That's all your tables and chairs, chalkboards, whiteboards, whatever. They're estimating $100,000 for that. Kitchen equipment, all new commercial kitchen equipment, $50,000. That's an additional $350,000. So basically what we're looking at to get in that building right there that you see before you with all of these additional costs is $3.43 million. That is a guess. That is a budget. That is a high budget, more than likely. We're not going to know what the final budget is until probably February, what the final number is going to be, hard number is going to be. After this part right here, we have to go into the actual design phase. We will be meeting with different areas in the church, different ministries, and we will be talking about what you need, how we need to incorporate it into this footprint. For an example, we'll be meeting with Jamie and Tammy and JR and Laura about the children's area. We have a concept now, but now we need to tweak it to make it work for them, for the children. Same thing with the youth, working with Pete and his people there, working with Brother Allen and Gail and the staff in the administration area. We'll be working a lot with Greg over the discipleship on how the adults will take place. Those are all things that we've got to work on next. The schedule will be, at this point, we'll be starting drawings. If the church approves this, folks, yes, next Sunday, we'll be starting the following Monday. We will have a meeting. We will be starting drawings the week after Thanksgiving. And they're saying it's going to take the rest of February, which will just about be over, be December and January, and we'll have drawings complete by February. We'll start our pre-construction stuff and getting shop drawing stuff done through March, permits and everything. Go through this, that's not all on there, but basically what's going to happen is we'll be done April 2018 is when this building is be done with what we got right here. So for conclusion, to wrap this up, I know everybody's ready to go. I've taken a lot more time than I was aiming to. Remember, this is conceptual at this time. We're voting on contractor, architect, and the look that we're going to get at First Missionary Baptist. Everything that we've asked for, they've included in 22,750 square foot. If you take the what they give us, a 3.08, that's roughly $135,000 a square foot. Pinnacle, yeah, $135, I'm sorry. Basically, what Pinnacle told us is depending on how elaborate, what we change, what we put in for furnishings, we can range anywhere from $125 to $175 per square foot. Just completed a church. I was actually there last Sunday for open house, and that job was completed for $145 a square foot. So we're right in the ballpark. As I said, the phasing, the drawing plans, pricing and permitted February to March, start March 2017, and we'd end somewhere around April 2018. So that's all I've got. That's all I've got to give you. Do you have anything else?
Just Wednesday night, we're going to have an open meeting.
Hand him the mic.
Here. No, I'm not sure what time.
6:15.
Wednesday night at 6:15 in the...
right here.
Right in here, we're going to have question, answers, whatever.
Before that,
chance
we're going
to
have
talk about it.
Thanksgiving meal. So everybody come. 5 o'clock, Thanksgiving meal. The ladies, I know, have worked hard to put that together for us this week. So.
Well, amen. Amen. Let's stand together. Let's give God a hand clap of praise for His good. Yeah.
I just want to say one more thing. If you have any questions, you want to know more about it, talk to any one of the committee members. They can help you answer some questions. If not, Steve can answer them. Everybody go see Steve. I'm going to run, or you don't ask me anything.
Amen. Amen. Well, a whole lot of work, many years, many prayers, a lot of faithfulness. God's sustaining grace is behind what you've seen today. It's pretty neat to be a part of this, to be a part of the history and legacy of this body. And this is something that will outlive all of us. It'll be generations, many generations long ahead of us. So we're praying that it'll be an effectual ministry tool, gathering space, container, statement to our community that God will use many, many, many years from now, reaching people who don't know God, people who don't know, have a church background, people who don't know anything about Him. A gathering place they can come and hear the gospel. Amen? And hear the gospel. So, Lord, we stand here today with this baton of the gospel. Many have held it before we have held it, God. But all of our lives here today, at least us being here today, Father, is a result of someone passing the baton, having trust, looking to You, having a heart for people who are far from You, God. We're here today because somebody passed the baton. As we hold it now, Father, I pray in Jesus' name that we will get self out of the way. We will see You. And we'll make decisions, Father, that will help pass the baton to generations to come. Father, we pray against Satan today. We pray against the evil one. We know that he is not for any movement of You, Father. He would have stopped this building in 1958 and this gathering of people. He tried to stop it in 1933, Father. But because Your people moved forward, He was never victorious. So, Father God, today in the name of Jesus, we pray that You bind Satan from our hearts, our minds, and this fellowship. Keep him far away, Father. Give us clarity of heart and thought and faith. Give us unity and love for one another. And give us a great passion, Father, for those who are far from You and the ministry ahead. May that be where our heart is, the ministry, Father. Thank you for the folks who've served, who presented this today, Father, in the days to come. Make it clear. And may Jesus be glorified. I pray this in His holy name. Amen and amen. God bless you for being here today. You are dismissed.